church. Back 400 years, when the Protestant Reformation was sweeping across Europe. Catholicism was under threat. The rites and rituals of the old faith were being questioned, and even the very fabric of the church was under attack. All across Northern Europe, images, paintings, sculptures, stained glass windows were being ripped out of churches and placed on the bonfires of the Reformation. Back in the heartlands of Catholicism, Spain and Italy, the realization dawned that something had to be done. The Roman Catholic Church mounted a counter-offensive. They aggressively redeployed old artistic traditions as a powerful new form of propaganda. The Catholic Church desperately needed to reconnect with the mass of ordinary worshippers, and nowhere was the project pursued with more intensity than Spain, where every church was to contain images of Jesus, Mary, and the saints that were so real you could almost reach out and touch them. ...17th-century Spain became a factory for the production of shockingly realistic statues, carved from wood, painted in lifelike colours. These polychrome sculptures were crafted to reignite the ecstasies of Catholic worship. The National Gallery's new exhibition, The Sacred Made Real, has gathered some of the most startling examples. This is an image of the dead Christ. It was created by a sculptor called Gregorio Fernandez, working in collaboration with an anonymous polychrome painter in about 1625. And it's an extraordinary essay in almost grotesque naturalism. Christ has just this moment, you feel, just this moment been taken off the cross. This is a body laid out for burial, but it hasn't even yet been washed. His flesh might almost be warm. Rigor mortis might just about be setting in. The flesh is slightly blue. There are all kinds of extraordinary touches of naturalism. Look at the half-open mouth in the last death agony. There are teeth in there made of ivory. The eyes are made of glass. Incredible details of the nails, these chipped nails. The suffering body has been recreated with almost the precision of a doll maker or a mannequin fashioner. Looking at it, you feel almost as if you're in a mortuary. It's a very, very powerful experience. It's right on that membrane of where you're not quite sure if you're looking at a work of art or actually looking at a real human body. The whole point of a work like this is to make you feel as if you are in the presence of the dead Christ, as if it had just happened yesterday. It had just happened an hour ago. Christ has just died, just this minute, to save you, to make you really believe again, to make you really feel that when you go to your church and you worship in front of an object like this, yes, you have almost touched the sacred mystery of his sacrifice. Of course, in the end, it's only an image, an illusion, but what a brilliant piece of manipulation. And once you've seen it, it's pretty hard to forget. The sculptures depended on lifelike detail for their impact. This head of John the Baptist is anatomically precise. Right down to the severed windpipe and vertebra. All that realistic gore. Squeamish art historians have tended to put these sculptures on a par with the waxworks at Madame Tussauds. But this exhibition places them besides paintings of the era by Spain's great masters. Zurbarán. Velázquez. Who weren't only influenced by these sculptures, but may even have worked on some. Comparisons prove that these long-neglected statues are every bit as brilliantly crafted as the paintings. And they must have been far more vivid to the peoples of Catholic Spain. This was art designed not just to speak to the people, but also, if possible, to modify their behaviour. Pedro de Mena's Penitent Magdalene contemplates crucifixion, wears a skirt of rough matting. She's mortifying the flesh. She is, in effect, a polychrome role model aimed directly at Seville's large population of prostitutes. Emulate her, mend your ways, and maybe, just maybe, you'll get to heaven in the end.
There were once sculptures like this all across Europe. The churches of England were full of them, but here they were ripped out because for Protestants they courted idolatry. So uncannily realistic that the faithful might worship the sculpture itself, not what it represented. And it might seem extraordinary, but the sculptures still arouse those kinds of passions today.
I've been asked to stand no closer than this to this much venerated image of the Mater Dolorosa, the Sorrowful Virgin. She's one of the most precious possessions of the monastery of San Joaquin y Santa Ana in Valladolid, and the nuns of the monastery only reluctantly agreed to lend her to this exhibition. In fact, when they were first approached, all 16 of them dropped a black marble into the rosewood box, signifying 16 no's. It was only when the National Gallery sent a special envoy to plead their case that the nuns agreed to let her out and be exhibited here. We've even been asked not to zoom in too closely on her face, the camera regarded as an intrusion. To many people in modern Spain, these are not just precious works of art, they're cult objects, holy things.
Unlike almost any other art form in history, these sculptures are part of an unbroken tradition, reaching from the dawn of European Christianity to the present day. During Holy Week in Spain, they're paraded among worshippers. Some of the statues are 400 years old, but many of them are modern creations. No one tries to paint like Velázquez anymore, but the folk tradition of crafting these sculptures survives today. They're still part of the fabric of Southern Catholic worship.
Vividly painted, realistic wooden sculptures like these have been central to the experience of Spanish Catholicism ever since they were first created. But they've rarely been taken seriously by art historians, partly, I think, because art history itself is a discipline that has its roots in the Protestant North, where images such as this have always been regarded with a certain amount of distrust, relegated to the lumber room of Catholic superstition. But by placing them alongside the great masterpieces of painters such as Velázquez or Zurbarán, I think this show, for the first time in a very long time, places them centre stage.
And that exhibition runs at the National Gallery.